Hey folks, it's Dr. Gilchrist. I managed to pick up my microphone from my office and bring it back home with me so I could do a quick little screencast for you. Now, my goal is to make sure that we get through schizophrenia. As you can kind of see, we don't have that much more to discuss. And then I will kind of circle back and talk about dissociative disorders as well as drugs of abuse. I'm going to try to keep this as quick as I possibly can. So the last time we were in class, we were talking about two very different types of symptoms associated with schizophrenia, what we call positive symptoms and negative symptoms. Positive symptoms are marked by inappropriate behaviors being present. That includes things like auditory hallucinations, which are by and large the most common type of hallucination that someone with schizophrenia will experience, as well as delusions, which include things like delusions of grandeur, delusions of paranoia, persecution, or control. And then we have our negative symptoms, which occur when actions and feelings are unexpectedly absent. So that will include things like a voice that has no tone or no emotional expression. So in terms of onset and development, one of the things that we know is that in general, it's a little bit more complex when you break it down by gender, but in general, it does tend to strike in young adulthood for males. It typically tends to be the late teens, early 20s. For females, it tends to be a little bit older, in that particular case, like mid to late 20s. It may typically develop gradually, so it's more insidious over time. The symptoms start building over time, or it could be sudden, which is what is sometimes referred to as a psychotic break. And one of the things that we know is that if it's gradual and it's much more insidious, it's much more difficult to be treated. So recovery tends to be, surprisingly enough, a lot harder if this is something that happens gradually versus something like a psychotic break. Now, here's what we know about schizophrenia. Schizophrenia is marked by a couple of different interesting things relating to the brain and neurotransmitter release. Now, in general, we do tend to find that there is excessive processing of dopamine or dopamine receptors in the brain. So what's kind of interesting is that there tends to be an excessive amount of dopamine in areas like the amygdala, which is really critical for negative emotional content, and might contribute to things like delusions or paranoia or things like that. But there tends to be considerably less dopamine circulating through the frontal lobe. And that might help explain things like anhedonia, avolition, where we don't really feel like doing anything, and possibly contributing to that flat affect. In general, relative to people who don't have schizophrenia, they tend to report having lower brain activity, rapid shrinkage, particularly in the frontal lobes. The frontal lobes are certainly not as large as they are in a healthier person. And the thalamus seems to play a role with respect to things like hallucinations. And the amygdala really seems to play a role with respect to the negative emotions that you feel, possibly coinciding with hallucinations or with those delusions of grandeur, persecution, paranoia, and so on. Now, what's interesting is that genetics also do seem to play a role. These things do tend to run in families, and they are certainly more likely for identical twins, not just because of the similar genetic component, but researchers also found that sharing a placenta also led to a greater incidence of schizophrenia. So this led to the very interesting idea that fetal development and the quality of the developing fetus and aspects related to nutrition or trauma during that early fetal development seems to play a role in whether or not schizophrenia develops. So prenatal environment can also hold a clue. So one of the more compelling theories about who is more and less likely to develop schizophrenia is that it's possible that these sorts of symptoms could be due to a disrupted prenatal environment by the mother contracting a virus while carrying a developing fetus. In particular, they seem to believe that this virus may potentially be the flu. We have some evidence for this, and part of the reason that you'll notice that there are multiple risk factors here is because all of these are correlated with the development of schizophrenia, but none of them on their own is sufficient. So one of the things that we know is that, first of all, there tends to be a greater incidence of adults with schizophrenia that were born during periods of flu epidemics, such as the Spanish flu supposed outbreak during World War I. Researchers have also found that if the mother had the flu while carrying a fetus, that child would be more likely to develop schizophrenia. We know that schizophrenia is more likely to occur in denser populations rather than in more rural populations. Obviously, the reason for that is that in denser populations, you have a greater likelihood of coming into contact with people, and people tend to like to carry germs. The more contact that you come into with people, the greater the likelihood that you could contract a virus. In contrast, with more rural areas, there's less of a likelihood of running into somebody, and thus less of a likelihood of developing flu. Additionally, one of the other things that we find is that your birth month matters. So in general, an interesting finding is that people that tend to be born in early spring and late winter tend to be a little bit more likely, like an early spring birth, tend to be more likely to develop schizophrenia than people born at any other time of the year. And part of the reason for that is that that tends to coincide with the peak of flu season during the second trimester, which tends to be pretty critical. So babies that are born in late February, March, early April are actually more likely to develop schizophrenia than people born in other months. Now, obviously, if we go into the southern hemisphere where the seasons are reversed, you're going to see a greater incidence of schizophrenia occurring for those that are born in months before their version of winter, which is our summer. So it's actually reversed. So all of these are different potential risk factors for developing schizophrenia. So I'm going to go back now and talk about dissociative identity disorder and the other dissociative disorders. So dissociative disorders occur when your conscious awareness basically splits and separates itself from painful memories and thoughts and feelings. Many of these are marked by things like identity change and a loss of memory. So we're going to talk about three of these. We're going to talk about dissociative identity disorder, which was previously known as multiple personality disorder, dissociative amnesia, and dissociative fugue. So dissociative identity disorder occurs when people report having two or more distinct alternating personalities. They are generally mutually exclusive. So when one personality is in control, the others are kind of pushed to the back burner. Each of these personalities is presumed to have different mannerisms, different behaviors. They have to be distinctive from each other. And until one goes to therapy, the original personality is not aware of these alternating personalities. They will not realize it until they recognize that there are gaps in time that they are not aware of. There is some skepticism about dissociative identity disorder. Since it was first reported in the Diagnostic Statistical Manual, the number of reported cases, as well as the number of personalities, has grown. Originally, it wasn't that uncommon to see somebody report having two additional distinct personalities. Now it's not that uncommon to see somebody report having something like 12 or more. Now, some of the other skepticism with dissociative identity disorder occurs because it's not really that common outside of the United States. And generally, this would suggest that there's a cultural emphasis here. And oftentimes, it's been reported that dissociative identity disorder occurs as a response to trauma. The fact that this only happens primarily in the United States, relative to other parts of the world, suggests that it is not a trauma issue, but a very different sort of issue. And especially during the 1960s and the 1970s, when this disorder was much more rampant, it was not uncommon to hear about therapists utilizing various resources, including various types of drugs that had addictive properties, to suggest to people that they had these alternating personalities. So it's not necessarily because of trauma. It could be due to suggestibility from therapists. Additionally, dissociative identity disorder is not that different from the idea of our normal multiple selves. Typically, the way that you behave in class is not going to be like the way that you behave with your parents or the way that you behave with your friends. That doesn't mean that those are different personalities. It's just that you have multiple selves. Now, I'm not saying that dissociative identity disorder does not exist, but I do occasionally wonder if some of the cases that are being reported are a bit overblown. So now, with the time we have left, let's talk briefly about drugs and substance abuse. I know you might actually be kind of surprised to see drugs and drug abuse in this chapter, but the truth of the matter is that all psychological phenomena that we talk about, including drug addiction, are biopsychosocial in nature. So this isn't just something that's related to biology. This is something that's related to society and psychology as well. So when we talk about drug abuse or addiction, what we are typically referring to is a substance use disorder or a substance-related disorder. This is typically something that is a maladaptive pattern of substance abuse. It leads to impairment in your daily life and work, and it leads to a lot of distress, either for you or for somebody else. Now, here's what's really critical. These drugs are what we call psychoactive. So I'm not talking about people who take too much ibuprofen. That doesn't really affect how your brain works. We're talking about drugs that affect the central nervous system and alter our perception and our mood. So addiction happens in a variety of different ways. In particular, this is where I do talk a little bit about biology. The more that you take of a drug, the better your body becomes at breaking it down. And as a result, you will eventually develop what is called a tolerance. Now, what's really critical is that with a tolerance, you have to take more of the drug to get the same effect that you had initially. So there's a diminishing effect with the same dose of a drug with repeated use. So here is a small dose. It has a somewhat large effect the first time you take it, but later on, it's not going to have as much of an effect. So the thing is that your brain and your body are still going to be affected. And depending on the type of drug, you may actually develop a dependence. Now, some drugs like alcohol and different types of opioids have very strong physical dependencies where the withdrawal symptoms are so unbearable that nobody wants to quit. In other cases, we can have more of a psychological dependence. And I'll talk more about this in a second.